Go and have fun, and we'll see you back for the closing praise songs.
Thanks, Lisa. I hope y'all are doing well this morning. Today, as you may be aware, is Veterans Day, and we want to take a moment to give thanks and show appreciation for those who have offered their lives to the service of this country. We know Jesus said the most powerful expression of love a person can do is to offer his or her life for another. And when you serve in the armed forces, there is always that possibility, and you know that going in. So would you allow us to just express a moment of appreciation this morning? If you've served in our armed forces in any capacity, would you stand for just a moment and let us give thanks for your service? Don't be shy. All right, let's give thanks. There you go. Thanks, man. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. God has given us an incredible land to live in, and we're very thankful for that. And talking about serving in another capacity, wow, look at this. I had the chance this week to drive down to Charlotte for just a couple days to see my mom and dad, and this happened while I was gone. That is amazing. And Operation Christmas Child, I talked with Tracy Untener, one of our children's ministry directors, and she says we still, this is the week. This is the week where this year we have agreed to be a collection center for the boxes. And so this week people are going to be bringing in boxes from other churches or just people from their homes. And what we need, where we need your help, is we have two-hour slots. These evenings and this week from Monday through Friday, with a little bit different on Wednesday. But we need some folks to come to just be here so that when folks bring their shoe boxes, you can help continue to build the wall of love here that is going up. And moms and dads with young kids, this is a great way to serve as a family. Now, certainly, if you don't have kids, this is a great way to serve without kids. But if you do, we often have families with young children saying we'd like to serve in some way with our children, and what can we do? And so we try to be attentive when opportunities come along for that. This would be one of those opportunities. The way you can sign up is a couple options. One, on our weekly e-news, you can check that out, and there's a link to go to a sign-up genius and sign up for that. But if for any reason you're not getting the weekly e-news or you're just not a computer type person, two other possibilities. One, call the church office and we'll connect you with Tracy Untener. Or if you know Tracy, I think it's right there, right Tracy? Raise your hand. If you know Tracy, you can go and talk with her and say, we'd like to serve this week to help as we collect these boxes. So it's really cool to see the way this is growing. And every one of these represents a boy or a girl who's going to be really excited this Christmas to receive these gifts. And it is cool, Raj. I know we say this a lot, but it's cool that you know this firsthand, what that feels like. So, all right. I think I have one other thing, but I didn't write it down. So, what was that third thing? Veterans Day, Operation Christmas Child, and... All right, that one's gone. So, what? Oh, well, that's a good one. The potluck, I know what it was. Thank you, that's out of my memory. Yeah, we do have a week from today, right? Potluck, after worship. Plan to be here, the people from Esperanza Viva. I know some of you know some of them and some of you don't, but the way we can just kind of get to know each other around a fun time together is just have a meal together. And so next Sunday after this worship, we're gonna move the chairs, set up some round tables, and just enjoy some Thanksgiving food together with our friends from Esperanza Viva. The other thing I was gonna mention is today we're gonna celebrate the life of Scott McCormick. That is why I'm dressed the way I am. Visitations at 2:00. And then at 3:00 in the sanctuary, we're going to celebrate his life. Reverend Bill Bowdell is helping to lead that time as well. So if you'd like to be here, we welcome you to come and be a part of that celebration. But regardless, lift up in prayer the McCormick family. I know Scott's wife's name is Robin, and they have a couple of children as well. So lift them up in prayer as well. Today is the fifth of a six-part series in Break Free, Becoming a Disciple-Making Community. And the subtitle today is Disciple-Making Struggles. we acknowledge that it's not always easy making disciples, but it's always worth it. It's always good. We're going to kind of launch from the Gospel of Luke chapter 10, verses 1 through 7, and then verse 17, as I'll read a passage that describes Jesus sending out disciples to go and prepare villages and towns, the people there, to meet him as he was coming to these villages and towns. It's on his pathway to Jerusalem, which we know is the pathway to the cross. And before he got to the cross, he wanted as many people as he could to meet him and know him as Savior and Messiah and Lord. And that's our desire as well. Every day we have an opportunity to help someone either be introduced to Jesus or to begin to know him as Savior and Lord. So hear these words from the Gospel of Luke chapter 10. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town and place where he himself was about to go. And he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I am sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. Carry no money bag, no knapsack, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace be to this house.' And if a son of peace is there, your peace will rest upon him. But if not, it will return to you. And remain in the same house, eating and drinking what they provide, for the laborer deserves his wages. Do not go from house to house." The 72 returned with joy. So, might pause between that. "Do not go from house to house." Pause. They went out. And then sometime later, the 72 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name." May God bless the reading and hearing of these holy words. Let's pause for prayer. God, as we gather together today, Lord, we are striving to continue to grow as far as in our walk with you. Lord, we worship you. We have some awesome classes and small groups. We serve in mission ministry. Lord, we're also working together to increase our competence and our confidence and sharing about Jesus and revealing about Jesus and walking with others on the journey to be like and to know Jesus. And so help us, Lord, this morning to do just that. We pray these things in your holy name. Amen. Amen. So this morning, as I mentioned, we're addressing what I've titled Disciple-Making Struggles. And although disciple-making is not always easy, I believe it's also not as difficult as we may tend to think of it at times. You know, these past 4 weeks, we've been digging into that which is involved with breaking free from institutional religion to become a living community of disciple-makers for Jesus. Summarizing the vision of where we're going as the people of Bethany, these two things come to mind. What we're striving to do is, first of all, we are developing a clear pathway to spiritual maturity. We believe that one of the ways, and we've talked and we've prayed and we're fasting, asking God to help us help others as we not only grow in our walk with Christ, but we want to help more and more people to do that as well, even more effectively than we have been. So we're striving to develop a clear pathway to spiritual maturity. And the second point is this: we're journeying on this pathway with one another. Together, we're asking the Lord to help us kind of figure it out as we go, and he's always faithful in doing that. It's kind of life on life, discipling as we invite, as we join with others, and as we do with others, so that no disciple is left behind. As we consider this model for a discipleship pathway, we're considering, how did Jesus do ministry? How did he make disciples? And we see that one of the things he did was he would at times gather with a large group. We know at times there were crowds of people, sometimes, you know, 5,000 and more at various times. And at these crowds, it would be a time where the people would be unified through the Spirit of God and also united together in worship. Jesus also connected with mid-sized groups. This morning's passage, talking about a group of 72. That'd be a mid-sized group. And at those groups, you're a little bit more intimate. You start to have fellowship with one another, and you would receive instruction from Jesus, and when he was doing it. And our hope is that when we do this, we will receive instruction as well. Some of our mission ministries, or what we might call mid-sized groups. And then Jesus would have small groups. The most commonly known group is the 12 disciples. And as you meet with a group of 12, and you all know this in the church settings, if you don't, then this is a great way to begin to feel assimilated. And by that, you begin to feel a sense of this is kind of my family, my church community. I belong to a part of these people. I don't know all, well, we're about 300. I don't know all 300. But I do know these 8, these 10, these 12 pretty well, small groups. So Jesus would do that with his disciples. And it was also a time for deeper spiritual growth as you could have conversation with each other as well. And then finally, micro-discipleship. And that's kind of the new part of making disciples that we together are growing to learn and to do. And in the Bible, we learn that Jesus would at times get together with Peter, James, and John. And maybe take them to teach them something in particular that they would then pass on later. Or there's times at the end of the Gospel of John where Jesus walked just with Peter and said, you know, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Because he was wanting to teach Peter something that Peter would then use later in his walk with others. And so taking this pattern of going from large to mid-sized to small to micro groups, we're striving to do the same thing here at Bethany, to grow more like Christ in a disciple maker's pathway. So we have our gatherings. The most common would be right here on Sunday morning, this gathering. But you all know we have some other gatherings as well, Vacation Bible Adventure and some other times when there's large number of people getting together. We have our Sunday classes. We have quite a few here on Sunday morning. And then we do have some classes that take place at other times as well. We have our what's called life groups. We typically have called them small groups. We're kind of transitioning to give these the name of life groups. And myself and Laura and others here will be talking about what we see a life group being, but basically a place where you'll grow even deeper in your walk with Christ. And then finally, we have the micro group where we're equipping disciple makers to know Christ, grow with others, and show the world. And although this is a linear, it really, you could take it and make it a circle so that the equipped disciple makers would then invite others to gatherings and the process continues. So that's kind of what we're striving to do here. But for just a second, let's consider the why. Because it's one thing to say, well, this is what we're doing, but why are we doing it? Why are we doing it? And the most simple answer is a statement we say over and over again, put it on our bulletin covers, and that is what? We're helping one another experience the life that God offers. That's what we're striving to do, helping one another to experience the life that God offers, which is eternal life, right? Not just life here on earth, but it's eternal life in God's heavenly kingdom. Now, I have these couple of pictures here because the reality is it's not always easy. It's not always easy as we help one another, as we make disciples. It's messy. Digging into living life with another person and you experience as you really get to know people, you know this, that you begin, what is it? You begin to love people warts and all for some reason. That's a statement that's sometimes said. And you pour out God's truth, but you also extend God's grace. And it can be messy, but it's always good. It's always good. Let's consider today's passage. In the Gospel of Luke chapter 10, Jesus sent out a group of 72 people. He did what I call it Noah's Ark style. He sent them out two by two. And it wasn't easy. We can read that there were stumbling blocks involved as he sent them out. He was heading to Jerusalem, and so he sent out these groups to go to all the villages and towns where he would then come to in the days ahead so that they kind of would prepare people to receive Jesus and recognize him when he arrived in their town. And so there were stumbling blocks along the way, but there was a joyful outcome because they experienced the outcome of Jesus' plan. There's really no greater joy in life than to introduce someone to the life God desires they experience through Jesus Christ and then to see that taking place. And also, there's no plan B because Jesus doesn't need a plan B. What did he say to them before he sent them out? He says, here's the deal. He says, the harvest is plentiful. In other words, there are lots of people out there that would be blessed to experience the life that God is offering. I mean, couldn't we say that today? You and I know lots of people, coworkers and other students at school and people in our community that really, you know, neighbors, that would be blessed to begin to know the life God is offering. And so that's what Jesus is saying. The harvest is plentiful. There's plenty of people. He says, but what? The laborers are few. The laborers are few. And why is that the case? Well, the reality is disciple making takes commitment. It's easy not to do it. Disciple-making takes commitment, a commitment that we don't often see. So I think a question for you all and me today is, are you among the laborers that Jesus is calling? And did you catch the motivational speech that Jesus gave to these disciple makers before they went out? My hunch is, during yesterday's college football games, halftime, the coaches at halftime did not give a motivational speech like this. That's just my hunch, because Jesus says this. He goes, first of all, I want to let you all know that you're being sent out as lambs among wolves. Lambs among wolves. I mean, can't you picture the people kind of looking at each other and going, well, that's a real pick-me-up. Yeah, great. Well, what's next? Jesus says, well, here's the deal. Don't take any money, and don't take any extra clothing as well. And then he says, just go into a village or a town and knock on the door and extend God's peace to them. And if he or she returns the peace to you, which, by the way, this must be where, I know a lot of times in the Catholic Church, do y'all do that, the passing of the peace? Well, you can know it's not limited to Catholics, that and they've never said it is. But here's just a little spot where, yeah, peace be with you and also with you. Well, there you go. Jesus says, go out, extend that peace. And if they basically welcome you with hospitality, then stay in their house while you're in that village, while you're in that town. Don't go to a bunch of other places. Stay with them. Eat what they serve you. Be a good guest. And so basically that was the plan, and you know, it sounded like a plan for either those who were just fully sold out, said, all right, Jesus, you know, this is not exactly the most pick-me-up speech I've ever heard, but you know what you're doing, I trust you, or people that were just a little bit crazy and like, well, okay, I don't know, or maybe both, but God was using them, because there was risk involved. There was risk involved that when they went to share about Jesus is coming and he wants to meet you, there's risk involved, and not everybody is going to be overjoyed at that idea. So this was the life God's Son was offering. But what did the 72 experience? Well, we know sometime later, probably when Jesus was getting to each of the towns, each of the villages, we read that they were filled with joy. And we can imagine they were sharing about God's kingdom. I picture people being healed as they were ministering. And it says in Luke 10:17, the 72 returned with joy, saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. They're like, this is great. Man, I'm glad I'm involved in this. It's not easy, but I can't think of anything I'd rather be doing, is what I see them saying. And so this morning, I want to take just a few moments to talk about some of the struggles that you and I face when it comes to disciple making. Because Jesus may not be physically here saying, well, you're going out as lambs against wolves and don't take any money. But I know that we have things in our lives that are like, I hear what you're saying. I know this is good, but here's some of the struggles I'm dealing with. So let's talk about those this morning. First of all, feelings of insecurity. Feelings of insecurity. And I'm gonna mention three things that contribute to feelings of insecurity. The first is this: I was never discipled. I never had anyone do this in my life. So you're asking me to do something that I don't really have past experience myself in doing. And you know what? I get this. This is true for me, Doug Sonnenberg, personally. And it's why we're striving to set up a disciple-making pathway to spiritual maturity here at Bethany. My Christian upbringing and that of my children is what we would call participating in the church as an institution. Now, and I know, David, before the offering, by the way, I love the way you kind of lead us into the offering. Well done. But you sound that kind of like corporate worship. It sounds a little cold, the church as an institution. And what I would do as a child and what my sons would do, we would attend events. Worship, we called that going to church rather than being the church. We went to Sunday school. We went to potluck dinners. And the reality is these were good things. And we did meet people there. And we did develop some relationships. And we were blessed. And by God's grace, he helped me and he's helped others to grow to be followers and even disciples of Jesus. And so these were good, even sacred events. But the closest thing I ever experienced to what we're striving to describe as disciple making with another person or two, that didn't take place till I was a young adult, my 20s, when Beth and I were invited to gather with this small group of, it started with, I think, six people, six or seven. And the leader began to challenge us, one, to first find your Bible, and then start reading your Bible, and then we would study the Bible, and the seven of us began talking verse by verse, different books of the Bible, about what it means, how that applies in our life, how we can be like Jesus. I'd never experienced this before, and it was cool to see what began to happen. We began to grow closer in our relationship with Christ, and God began to work in our lives. Two of us, we hadn't planned this, but two of us ended up going into pastoral ministry, but every person was changed. And not only that, did we grow closer to God, but we began to grow closer to one another. This friend, this leader, he would invite me over to Frisch's usually to just talk and begin to grow. And so I was growing closer to these friends, brothers and sisters in Christ, and to God. I'd never experienced anything quite like that before. And it's funny, and God used that then to invite me to a concert, a Christian concert at Middletown High School way back in 88. And that's when life really began to change. And so I was never discipled the way we're describing it, but God's saying, that's okay. We can learn and grow together. Secondly, something that kind of contributes to a feeling of insecurity is I don't know enough. And this is a response we hear a lot, that, you know, I don't know enough. I can't disciple somebody else because I hardly know the Bible myself. And this is really important this morning. Please listen. Disciple making is more like parenting than it is mentoring. When you limit yourself to the mentoring model, and there's nothing wrong with the mentoring model, and in some circumstances, that's an excellent model to be used. It's certainly appropriate. But if you limit yourself to just thinking of a mentoring model, you may tend to think of the wise, all-knowing teacher with the entry-level student soaking up your every word. And that's not what we're talking about here with disciple making. I mean, it could be a rare exception. But in general, disciple making is more like parenting. You kind of figure it out as you go. I mean, those of you who, you remember, especially when you have your first child, you know more than the kid, so that's a blessing, but you're far from a parenting expert, right? When you start parenting, you're not an expert, you're just learning as you go together. You talk with other parents. You talk with your parents. And so right up front in a disciple-making relationship, you just acknowledge that I'm learning, you'll be learning, together we'll learn. And if we come across something that we're not familiar with, you know, you dig into those passages like good old Leviticus and that kind of stuff, you're like, let's figure it out together. In fact, you know, really sometimes too much information kind of makes it hard to apply because you get all this information. But if you haven't been in the culture of applying it as you go along, sometimes that can become a little bit of a burden. So, in fact, here's a parenting analogy. Discipling is like teaching a child to tie their shoe for the first time. What is that about? Age 4? Age 5? I'm with the Velcro stuff. I'm not quite sure. Is it four? Thank you. Thank you. We have an example here that's telling me this, a young man. So let's say age 4 or 5, what do you do? I mean, can you picture like kind of looking over your son or daughter or if you're a teacher in a Sunday school class and the shoe comes untied, you just go, all right, now, first you cross the laces over. No, you cross just once. And then it's like, the bunny goes around the tree. And it's like, no. And you know, that would be, you don't do that, right? In fact, it sounds silly. What do? You get down and either help with their shoe, or maybe you tie your shoe as he or she imitates what you're doing. And you don't do it once, right? As mom and dad, you do it over and over and over. You kind of learn to tie your shoe together, even though you already know how, because what? They begin to learn it. And that's what disciple making is. Together, we're just kind of figuring out, trusting that God is helping us do that. A third thing that contributes to feelings of insecurity is, I don't have the right gifts to disciple. You know, I'm not extroverted. I'm more introverted. I'm not really a people person, those kind of things. But remember this, when Jesus was just getting this movement started, who did he invite? He invited a few fishermen. He invited a tax collector. One of the guys was known mainly as kind of a political zealot. He would have fit in well in this day and age, right? But And yeah, and given, if Matthew the tax collector had had depended upon Peter the fisherman to do his taxes, you know in a few months the IRS would have come knocking at his door. And if Peter the fisherman had depended upon Matthew the tax collector to provide the food for each meal, they would have done a lot more fasting and praying and gone without food. So we do acknowledge that certainly people have unique gifts that can be used in various ways. But Jesus is saying, use those gifts with the people you know, and you can all make disciples. I imagine some of Peter's first disciples were other fishermen. I'm just guessing that. The Bible doesn't really tell us, but there were other fishermen. And maybe Matthew was good as far as just sharing about Jesus, a life of following Jesus, with other number crunchers, other bean counters, you know, the accountant people, financial analysts, all the tax folks. And so Jesus is saying, just like you can all love one another, you can all do this as well. So just a couple other things I want to go through quickly. We have feelings of insecurity. Here's a big one here, and we've talked a little bit about this, is I just don't have time. I don't have time. Many of us here do lead busy lives, and I've acknowledged I'm working on that in my own life. Perhaps we're too busy, but regardless, when it comes to disciple making, we're just talking about doing life together. So a question for this morning is, do you eat? And I can look around and I see that the answer is, at 8:30 they took offense at this, but I just see the answer is yes, you obviously do eat, you gotta live. And so chances are the friend that you might disciple eats as well. So there you have it. Find a regular time in the midst of your schedule, your busy schedules, to eat and then talk together. I mean, that's how Jesus did it often. Lazarus, come down from that tree because I'm going to have dinner at your house tonight. And even in Revelation, the last book of the Bible, it says, Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears me, opens the door, what? I'll come in and eat with him or her. So he uses that as an example of a perfect time. Two of my favorite Thursday evenings of the month begin with eating. We have a group here, we call it the Disciple Making Leadership Team, and it's basically a small group of folks that are kind of encouraging one another as we unravel this disciple making together. And we used to meet here at the church in the annex, and it worked out okay, but those with small children had to get babysitters, and we had to make sure a room was open, and so now we just all bring some kind of a food item, and we gather at the home of one of the couples. And if you have kids, bring your kids along, and we eat together, we laugh, we talk, we pray. So how might you disciple? You could run errands together. Go to Lowe's or Home Depot. Maybe help a neighbor together. And then talk about what God's been showing you lately in your life. That's the key. It's not just relational. That's the part I find easy. It's the intentional part. Talk about what God seems to be doing in your life. There's no right or wrong script. That's the beauty of it. Disciple making is simply some combination of being relational and being intentional and trusting God to help you all on the journey. We have video this morning. Laura Gregg recorded a little bit about how she fits disciple making into a pretty busy life. So I invite you to watch and listen at this time.
So one of the common questions I get asked is, how do you make disciple making work in your life? I don't need something else to do. And oh my goodness, that is so true for me. I don't need another Bible study. I don't need something else, another appointment I have to be at. And so how do I make it work? And so I tend to try to do things that I'm already doing. I do it messy. I do it without makeup on, and I just squeeze it in with the relationships I have. I build those relationships with intentionality as we move forward. So one of the things that an example is one of my dear friends who I love very much, and I want her to know the life God is offering to her in Jesus. And so I took the intentional first step. Instead of meeting at my Y and exercising like I normally do, I decided to go to her Y, and we've set up weekly appointments to work out together, drop the kids off at Child Watch, and as we run around the track, we talk and we open up, and I share what Jesus is doing in my life. And so that's just one sort of intentional step that I took to make it fit in my busy life. And it's a way that we're building relationally, that we can share. She can ask questions, but it won't stop there. And in fact, my next sort of intentional step is that we can begin to kind of use our cool down time to open up God's word and have a little just adult conversation. Maybe we've talked about going and grab smoothies. And so I think that's what we're going to do next, is to just spend an extra 10, 15 minutes after our workout, as we cool down, to go a little bit deeper, to have more intentional conversations.
There you go. I have to admit, I like to go and get a smoothie a little better than trying to talk as I'm running around a track, but it'd be good. And I too will do it without makeup as well. But thanks, Laura. I appreciate you sharing that. A third and final one I want to share this morning, as far as that's a disciple-making struggle, is just a simple fear of rejection. I mean, isn't it interesting how, I don't know about you, but this fear of rejection has kind of followed me from junior high to high school and now into adulthood to some capacity. I mean, what if they think I'm weird? And what if they start avoiding me every time they see me because they're afraid I'm going to be talking about Jesus again? Or what if they just finally say, nope, I'm not interested? No question about it. Being a disciple maker takes a certain amount of courage. That's been the case with God's people for thousands of years. God said to Joshua, when he was in charge of the people after Moses had gone on to heaven, he says, you know, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, because I'm with you. God said to Gideon, when he found him in the wine press hiding, he's like, oh, great and mighty warrior. He says, don't be afraid. God said to Mary through the angel Gabriel, do not be afraid, for the news I have is that God, you are well-favored in God's sight. And you know, one of the things I found that helps when I begin to talk with someone about, hey, what would you think about maybe getting together kind of regularly to talk about, you know, life and what God's doing, look at the Bible. I said, let's say if we're going to meet weekly, I'll say, well, how about we meet six weeks, and then we just kind of are being honest along the way after that, as far as how's this going, is it working, does it seem to be fitting in, and if it does, great, we keep going. And if it doesn't, and that's been my experience a couple times. We said, that's okay, we're still friends, you know, still love you, no harm, no foul, and we just kind of keep going, see where God would lead us next. As cliche as it may sound, you just have to trust Jesus, because just like the 72, he wouldn't have said, go and do this if you and I couldn't do this. So again, looking at the disciple maker's pathway again, and kind of looking for an action item this week. Here's the action item I'm going to talk about as we think of our gatherings for worship, our Sunday classes, life groups, and then disciple maker kind of micro groups. Here's some possibilities. Pray. I'd ask you to pray for a specific name or names this week, and ask God to encourage you to do at least one of these things. And here, the first one is this, and it's nothing new, that a specific name of somebody that you might invite to come to a gathering. You could be invite to come to worship, and you'd be with them, or one of the other gatherings. Even next week, if you just want to invite them to come and eat after worship, because people like food, and not even go to worship, that's fine. Just invite somebody. Secondly, pray for a specific name. So if you don't, again, one of these, two of these, three of these, pray somebody that you might invite to join you if you're in a Sunday morning class. And he or she is not, just invite them to, hey, come. Why don't you come? We have this class that meets together. Get to know some other people. We'll grow together. A third thing would be to invite someone to come and do some kind of mission ministry with you. Yesterday morning, Beth and I had been invited to go with the servants to the least of these. And there was a little bit of a resistance, because you got to get up at the wee hours of the pre-dawn morning. And yesterday it was a twee bit chilly in downtown Cincinnati, to put it mildly. But I tell you, but we got up and went down with this group. And it's incredible, I tell you, when you're standing and talking. One, the people downtown that were homeless, they're just so cool. It's just so good to just meet new people. And they were so appreciative. I had a box of gloves. And you can imagine yesterday, those gloves disappeared quickly because their hands were freezing. And you know, as we're driving home, I was just like, thank you, Lord, that some folks here invited us to go and be a part of that mission ministry. So wrapping up today, I think of Romans 8:37. You know, God said through the Apostle Paul, you're more than conquerors. You're more than conquerors. In other words, you can do this. So I would just ask that we pray as we move forward together. We'll see who God is calling us to invite and to join with and to do ministry together in this thing called disciple making. Let's pray as the band comes back up. Lord Jesus, as we gather today, I do thank you, Lord, that you've given us examples in the Bible of how you sent people out. And I thank you that you reveal some of the struggles, some of the challenges, but also the blessings that they experienced. And so, Lord, right now, I just have a sense that there are those of us here, and I've been there where I'm saying, wow, I just don't know who I would invite. I don't know who I would ask to join us. And so, Jesus, we're just kind of putting it out there that we ask that today and in these days ahead, that you would bring names to mind and that you would put together circumstances that are encouraging, Lord. I ask that you would bring about circumstances where we could invite people to come and worship, to come and eat, to just get together at Starbucks, to come to a Sunday class. Help us, Lord, to find the courage and the faithfulness to take the next step, because we know that you're always faithful to us. Lord, we so desperately in our communities need to know the life that God is offering. And you've chosen us to be the mouthpieces. And as we're honest, we often feel ill-equipped. And so I pray, Lord, that you, the one who is perfect, that you would send your Holy Spirit into us and help us, Lord, to be these mouthpieces, to invite others to know you. And help us, Lord, to also get to know you better each and every day. We can't do it without you, Jesus. And we're thankful you told us you'd always be with us. So we're looking to you, Lord, to help us make this a reality. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.